As Thomas mentioned, I've actually had an opportunity to work in PKI for 20 years. I've been a CA, I've been a root store provider, I'm an author of one of the OCSP RFCs, today I'm here talking to you about certificate transparency as product manager for that project. I think my experience in the PKI industry gives me a unique perspective maybe on the value of certificate transparency, and that's really what I'm hoping to share with you today and give you a little bit of insight on what we're doing and where at least I see it going in the future. So certificate transparency is about giving everybody else the visibility into the practices of CAs that a browser has. So if we look at the incidences of misissuance that have happened, the first ones that have historically been caught have been for sites like live.com, google.com, and that's because the people who operate those services also happen to have browsers. And those browsers send back telemetry that give them the ability to detect when there's a certificate that's in use that maybe they didn't intend to be issued. Certificate transparency gives everybody in this room and all of our customers the same ability, or at least that's the goal, is it gives visibility into the issuance practices of a CA, of the ecosystem of CAs, and enables building rich tools that allow notification of issuance of certificates, and give a number of other values as well that I'll talk a little bit about. So one of the things that it does is it helps with this problem of early detection. I'm sure we all remember DigiNotar, and if you have not read the Black Tulip report, it is, if nothing else, entertaining reading. And you'll see that what happened there was they were compromised for a long time and were being abused for a long time, and nobody really had any idea. Historically, when browsers would accept roots into their program, they relied exclusively on these point-in-time audits. You know, once a year, a couple times a year, somebody would come in, do a statistical sampling of what happened, and then in between there was basically no visibility. And DigiNotar is an example of that process failing the internet community, because they were able to proceed owned for a very long time without anybody really noticing. And if it wasn't for the fact that they picked a highly sensitive domain or one of somebody who owned a browser, we probably wouldn't have caught them for even longer. So early detection is a big value that certificate transparency gives. I know in this room we've got a lot of people who worry about deploying interoperable systems, and while this is not the next item on the list, this is something that I personally find massive value. And when I look at certificate transparency, it gives me insights into what people are actually doing in their certificates. And that means to me, as somebody who builds software, is I can look at the practices that are involved in the real certificates in the world today and ask myself, how will my software behave when it encounters one of these certificates, instead of doing one of these spreadsheets that we've probably all done before, where we map out the extensions that we're going to put in certs and say, gosh, I hope that everybody else came to the same assumptions I did. And so certificate transparency lets us have visibility into the corpus of all of the certificates that are out there and the practices involved. It also helps us have better insights into what's really happening in the ecosystem, and allows us to put into practice changes in the way that root stores are managed, in the way that browsers and other user agents behave in dealing with those certificates. And overall, I personally believe that it nets a much stronger web PKI ecosystem because of the clarity of what we have into both practices and what is actually deployed out there today. So, the history of certificate transparency. Well, I was not involved with Google at this time. It really does, if you do a little bit of archaeology, you find out that it really started right around DigiNotar. You'll notice that within, honestly, a few months of DigiNotar's event, We have the first draft of 6962, the certificate transparency RFC. It didn't take that long for that experimental RFC to be published CT implementations to start to roll out. We are a number of years into this long deployment. You'll see I don't have an end on my timeline here because there's a lot of things that need to happen yet. Today, about 90% of all certificates are logged to CT. That logging does not happen proactively, it happens asynchronously, and I'll talk a little bit about the way that that works, or at least the large majority of them. About 8% of SSL certs or EV certs in the web PKI ecosystem, and those certificates are mandated to have EV in Chrome, I can't talk about specific failure rates, I can say it's a very, very, very small number. So it's working effectively. And as what I'll be talking to you about is sort of what my roadmap and vision is for certificate transparency, and that fundamentally boils down to expanding that to the rest of the web PKI SSL ecosystem. Some wins that you can see in this is that we just recently, Apple has added support for CT for iOS applications. If you watch the Firefox repo, you can see that they are actively working on CT support in Firefox. So we're seeing CT expand from being a Google thing to being an internet thing. And that has always been the goal of certificate transparency. And we'll see that continue. So we've a number of early wins for CT that we saw. The first little block here is from a blog post from Facebook, where they talk about how they have found a number of issues that allowed them to protect their users as a result of having certificate transparency available to them. And it's an interesting example in that Facebook, of course, has lots of resources, and they can go and build web crawlers to go and discover these things, but it is not something that they naturally have. But they have a lot of very sensitive information that others would like to be able to see. And being able to find out when there are misissuances associated with their namespaces has proven valuable to them, so much so that they've actually announced in this blog post that they're going to make a public monitor available for certificate transparency. And I'll talk a little bit more about the role of a monitor later. Komodo has produced an excellent tool building on top of that corpus of certificates that's given great insights into the practices of CAs called crt.sh. It's the first place I actually go to look at a problem in that it makes it very easy to be able to look at technical nitty-gritty details about the certificates that are logged, and he's integrated in a number of tools that make it possible to find common mistakes. And overall, I think crt.sh has probably made more difference to combined with something called CertLint by a gentleman by the name of Peter Bowen, probably done more to improve the quality of certificates that are used on the web in the last 3 years than the preceding five. We also have the DigiCert certificate monitor, and we have DigiCert here. They were the first, actually, I believe, to come out with a monitor. And if not, it certainly is the most attractive of the monitors by my estimation. Census, which is a University of Michigan project for crawling the internet via a different set of methodologies and making that information exposed, is also built on top of certificate transparency and has talked about a roadmap of how they'll further integrate with it. So while I look at these different organizations building on top of certificate transparency, for me, it's a validation that this is providing value to the internet and the ecosystem that exists. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about how certificate transparency works, because I imagine not everybody's fully aware of it. So this diagram is horrible, like most cloud diagrams. As it tries to do too much. But at a high level, we'll say in the simplest case, a certificate authority, before it issues a certificate, will request send a message to a CT log asking the CT log to produce a statement that it can include in a certificate as sort of a proof that the certificate is a commitment to issue. It basically says, log, I would like to issue a certificate that looks like this. Please give me a cryptographic piece of evidence that I can use, and in the simple case, include it in the certificate I'm going to issue, so I can prove to relying parties that this certificate was logged. This process can happen synchronously or asynchronously. Today, a large majority of the certificates are logged asynchronously. EV certs, on the other hand, will typically be done synchronously because the user agents will require this log this log statement to be present in the certificate before it is trusted. And for that reason, CAs will hold back that certificate until they have successfully logged it and can provide relying parties the corresponding evidence. That certificate goes back to the user agent just like it does today. And as part of the post-validation of the cert, just like we do with revocation checking, it looks to make sure that that SCT is present, and that is used to determine, in the case of EV, whether or not you get the green badge or not, as one of the many factors. So there's a lot of components that exist in this ecosystem, the first of which is logs, and there's a healthy ecosystem of logs. I should know this count, but I want to say there are 8 logs currently. There's a web page, if anybody would like to see, that CAs will submit these logs to. Our general advice is that to a CA is that they broadcast the request for these cryptographic proofs to all of the logs at once, and then they pick the quorum that comes back and embeds them in the certificate, so that they can meet the various user agent policies of logging that may exist. In the case of Chrome, that is that there are 3 logs. I believe it is 2 of which are Google. I should probably know that one off the top of my head, but forgive. If you go to certificatetransparency.org, you will see a list of the known logs that are there. Another component is submitters. And submitters, in my first example I gave you, the submitter was the CA. But that's not always the case. So Census goes and scans the entire IP space looking for certificates on some very regular basis. And they collect all of that data. And when they find those certificates, they submit them to the logs. That's an example of a submitter who is not a certificate authority. And there's lots of them, actually. Individuals will sometimes find a corpus of certs that, for whatever reason, has not been logged, and they'll go and manually submit them. The goal for certificate transparency is that CAs are the submitters, or at least the principal submitters, so that we can move to a world where we can rely on CT as a source of truth for what is actually deployed today. But it's valuable that anybody can be a submitter. And CAs, certainly all EV CAs are in that list of submitters. The other one is monitors. There are a number of monitors that exist. Graham here has a monitor where he's looking at the uptime of these logs. We, of course, at Google maintain a monitor, and there are a number of others that are out there. There are auditors. Some monitors are also auditors. So an example of an auditor would be the CRTSH. It both monitors log availability as well as looks at the corpus of certificates for practices. So you can see in the corner here that he's got this option for cablint. And this is a set of rules that it will apply against the corpus of certs, looking for violations to the musts, may, shoulds, and just general best practices of certificate formation. And it makes it very easy to be able to spelunk into all of the certificates that are out there and find mistakes and practice, as well as just understand the practices of CAs as they exist. And then, of course, clients. And in the client case, there is Of course, the user agents. And today, Chrome is the user agent of choice, as is iOS apps, now that they also support enforcing CT. As we move through 2017, I aspirationally hope to see Firefox and other user agents add support for the same policy, supporting the requirement of CT. The value that's been brought over the last few years from certificate transparency is, I believe, very apparent. I think that we will see more user agents adopted as we move forward. The first version of certificate transparency was an experimental RFC. And if you're familiar with the IETF process, the sort of the level of community engagement necessary for an experimental RFC is much lower. So immediately after completing the first experimental RFC for certificate transparency, work began on 6962 BIS, which is a standards track version of certificate transparency with a number of changes as a result of community participation. It's in last call right now, we'd encourage you all to take a look at it and provide feedback. We will, when it exits last call, we'll begin the process of migrating to this new version through 2017, if I had wood. Let's see, knock on wood. Another thing that we've done is through this exercise of deploying certificate transparency at a very large scale, we've learned a lot about how to scale the infrastructure where there's opportunities to do things more efficiently, and how to generalize this platform so it's useful for other problems. An example of that is this project we call Trillion. And so if you, in your mind's eye, imagine a software stack where the top layer is an application-specific system, and right below that is this transparency layer, this thing that implements the blockchain, which is really what certificate transparency is, and then below that, a database layer of some sort. What we've basically done is divided certificate transparency into these three chunks and taken that top part off and given ourselves a platform in which we can apply transparency to many different problems. And I'll talk to you a little bit about one called key transparency that we're building on top of that same infrastructure, but it's just one of many. We have a project going on exploring what a binary transparency solution might look like on that very same infrastructure. And this new generalized platform is not just valuable in that it is generalized, but it's also more scalable and more performant. And again, open source, like the current certificate transparency implementation. One of the things that I work on is trying to convince the web PKICAs to opt in to logging into certificate transparency proactively and hopefully synchronously eventually. As I mentioned, about 90% of all certs end up in the logs, but not all of them come from the CAs. A lot of them come from the Google crawler, from people like Census. Our goal is to see that move to ultimately all web PKICAs logging everything that they issue so that corpus is more complete. Another component related to that is that we want to give relying parties on these certificates an ability to say that I've chosen a CA that does offer certificate transparency. For example, DigiCert does provide certificate transparency to its customers, and their customers should have the option of saying, I want to tell the browser to require that transparency log exists. And so one of our projects that we're working on right now is how would that communication happen between the web server and the browser, and working with user agents to make sure that capability is supported, and hopefully take it through the standards process at the same time, so that anybody can implement it. And I spent a lot of time asking CAs to please log their DV and OV certs. And if you're not a CA and you're a customer of a CA, I'd like to ask that you do the same thing. It is a very helpful thing for the ecosystem. Expand use of CT is also dependent upon improvements to our logging ecosystem. We do have eight CT logs today. Those are all based off of the original 6962 RFC. As 6962 BIS comes out of the standardization process, one of the things that we'll be doing is working with CAs to standardize 6962 BIS as the way that they do logging and operate logs that are compatible with it. We also want to see a more robust set of logs that are out there. Today, many CAs operate their own logs, but there are not a lot of logs that are sort of generic. Like Google will let anybody log to us, but there are fewer third-party log infrastructures that do the same thing, and we'd like to see more of that. There's a number of sort of maturity model items that we track internally about how we grow our ecosystem. Today we have very robust monitoring, but we don't make as much of that. We don't make a lot of data available about our monitoring. So we would like to improve on that monitoring and make more of it available to relying parties and CAs. Today, if there is any data that anybody needs, whether you're a relying party or a CA, feel free to contact us and ask for it. Happy to go spelunking into the databases and gather all that data for you, but we would like to make it available in a more consumable fashion as well. We're doing work around leveraging the world's best distributed caching mechanism, aka DNS, to be able to use that as a mechanism for CT distribution. And there's this concept of gossip. So yesterday in Thomas's talk, he mentioned blockchain, and certificate transparency is a blockchain technology. Fundamentally, the Bitcoin blockchain is based on a Merkle hash tree, and so is Bitcoin. The difference, or one of the many differences between, say, Bitcoin and certificate transparency, is that certificate transparency doesn't have this proof of work component that exists in Bitcoin. And the security, the ultimate security of CT will come from this concept of logs gossiping with each other, sharing their views of the world with each other and looking at each other's trees to make sure that they are honest and they have not been modified. We call this gossip. And so in the next big push for certificate transparency, we'll be looking at how we can get gossip implemented across the logs so that it won't be just Google looking for acting as a monitor. And there are other monitors out there. As I mentioned, Graham has one. We will be working on how we can get gossip to be a fundamental part of log operations so that issues will be found even quicker. We're working with Firefox to enable CT reporting at this point, supporting them in their desire to be able to measure the implication of requiring CT. As I mentioned, expect CT and gathering data on CT usage so that we can figure out what changes we have to make in the way that the user agents behave, the way that logs behave, and the CAs behave, to be able to get to more ubiquitous use of certificate transparency. I wish it was as simple as deploying logs and getting browsers to check for CT, but there are a number of challenges that exist in the deployment of certificate transparency, many of which are not as large. We'll take this first one here of, is it possible to handle PII in certificates? Thankfully, SSL certs very rarely contain PII. Their purpose is to announce, a machine's identity and its affiliation to the user agent. But that's not the case of all certs. I think the people in this room are very focused on maybe less SSL and more end user or device certificates that may have PII in them. And CT, as it stands today, makes that all publicly crawlable. And so it's maybe not right for all of those applications. It was designed specifically for SSL. We have another project, this key transparency that I briefly mentioned, that is better suited to that problem set. And there's another issue of, as I put on my CA hat, when I was issuing certificates to one of our largest customers, they were measuring issuance time in 30 seconds. And if I have to wait for a response from three logs before I can issue my certificate, my 30 seconds would maybe turn into 60 seconds. And so that's a problem for a CA. So we spend time talking with CAs about the way they implement their logging infrastructure so that they don't sequentially go and say, ask log one, log two, then log three. Instead, they do this blast to all logs and then pick the best ones, which sort of helps with that problem. But this has historically been one of the barriers for CAs, is their existing infrastructure does not do this blast methodology. It does this sequential thing. There's this other problem of redaction, which is fairly frustrating, which I'd be happy to talk to everyone in this room about. But my personal philosophy, independent of my role at Google and independent of my role at a CA in the past, is certificates in the web PKI are public, especially machine certificates. That said, is there are certificates that are used for internal names. So, you know, corp.example.com. And some organizations have concerns about these names becoming discoverable or easily discoverable. I think everybody in this room is very technical and understands that that information is available via other mechanisms today. But that doesn't mean that there's not a concern of relying parties about it being centrally located in a very convenient store. And so redaction is one of the proposals of how that problem can be managed, in that you can log, just like a wildcard certificate, you can, in essence, say, this label is private. And how we can get to the point where this redaction concept is supported, or we decide as an industry that it's not supported, which would make me, or which would make me very happy, and it's certainly a much more solvable problem in my mind. But these are the three biggest challenges that I've encountered trying to encourage the adoption of certificate transparency to date. That PII topic, though, that takes us to key transparency. Can I see a hand of people who are familiar with Conex? So Conex is a... So when I started out, I remember publishing my PGP key to the MIT PGP server, which is, in essence, a SQL database with a thin piece of code on top of it. And if you watch any of the Bitcoin drama, you'll see that people like to publish backdated keys into PGP directories and pretend that they're Satoshi. And the mechanisms that exist inside of the PGP ecosystem for dealing with this are pretty poor. And it's the exact same problem you see in secure messaging apps like WhatsApp or iMessage. If we take iMessage, Apple acts as this trusted directory. And they can go in technically and modify that directory. And we all trust them not to do that. I carry an iPhone, I trust them not to do it. But that I have no way to verify that they have not done that. And if they do, you can man in the middle my communication with whoever I happen to be talking to, even though it is end-to-end encrypted. And so the Conex paper is an attempt by some students out of Princeton and other universities supporting it to provide a mechanism to make a tamper-evident log like certificate transparency for public keys. And unlike certificate transparency, these public keys often have PII associated with them. So Conex used zero-knowledge proofs to make it so that when you stored things in this log, you could only find them if you happen to know, for example, the email address that it was associated with, which would prevent you from being able to crawl every single key and create a great big directory of, you know, PII that you can go and use. it was great work, but it had a few scalability issues associated with it. And so we began work on a variation of Connex that we felt could scale to Google in size. And that is our key transparency work. It's built on top of that trillion layer that I mentioned, or it will be. It's in various stages of engineering right now. And you can think of it as a generic store for any public key. It could be used by WhatsApp, Signal, Allo, or your PGP client, your S/MIME client, as a way to be able to discover keys. And it would allow external entities to be able to see, oh, wait a minute, somebody changed that, which is not something that exists today in a scalable form. And we believe it will help build interesting PKI-enabled apps, as well as more end-to-end encrypted-enabled apps with better user experiences. And in particular, the better user experience is, I think, one of the most powerful things. So I'm sure we've all read the leading and trailing bits of a hash before, trying to make sure we're looking at the right certificate. That's not something I would wish upon anybody, not even you. And especially not true of a consumer app where you're dealing with encryption. And really, if you wanted to sum key transparency up, it's to give you get the assurances that the user has done that verification without having to do that verification, which means your user experience is, well, if you compare it to where you force people to do the thumbprint verification, it's significantly better. And if you compare it to the case where they don't do thumbprint verification, it's significantly more secure. So key transparency is an enabler for a refined user experience for those sorts of applications, and something that, as a software guy, I've wanted to build a long time, but it takes a massive amount of engineering to be able to do this competently and effectively. And since Google is open sourcing it, like they've open sourced certificate transparency, when I leave Google, I get to use it again. And you all can build on top of it today. Well, not today, but very soon, hopefully. And so this is the promise of key transparency. Refined, smoother user experiences for end-to-end encrypted communications, and tamper evidence in the event that it is ever modified. So we're working on an open source proof of concept implementation. Today, that proof of concept is based on certificate transparency and not Trillion. We will be working to move it to Trillion over the rest of this year. But our intention is to release that proof of concept soon and work with the community to revise the design of that solution so that it's appropriate for more solutions, not just the ones that we've managed to think about. Maybe others will find gaps in our design, and so we're looking forward to working with the community on that. And we'll be engaging with third parties, trying to convince them to integrate this into their product offerings. There's no substitute for practical learning of integrating a technology like this into a real-world product. So that will be a big push. And then after that, once we understand at-scale behavior for this, we'll be looking with working with the community to standardize the approach. At least that's the intention. So that is my talk. So I figured the rest of the time you could ask me questions, and I will do my best to answer anything that you have. Be kind.
Was a really awesome talk, thanks. Just have a quick question about the blockchain implementation that you're using. Is this something that is already something that the public can already talk to? Can I already communicate with that, or is this still in the pipeline somewhere?
It is.
And also, is it you're using a blueprint from some other blockchain implementation, or you're rolling your own, or
is so? All blockchains are based on this concept of a Merkle hash tree. So the question is our blockchain, certificate transparency, available today? This is the first question. It is. We've been operating these logs, I think, for 3 years based on this technology. If you were to look at the implementation details of certificate transparency, the the tree structure is different than in Bitcoin, but fundamentally the data structure is the same. They're both Merkle trees. And this future version that we're working on has a slightly different data structure associated with it, also a Merkle tree, just more genericized. Certificate of transparency today, fully open source, numerous implementations, interoperable implementations, and the new version that we're working on is sort of in its infancy. We have white papers on it. We have an open source implementation that, as of a few weeks ago, more or less works. We're building on top of that. So I hope that answers your question.
The blockchain block size debate, I think you're pretty much agnostic to that, because if I understood it correctly, it's just a Merkle tree and you're not like basing the implementation on Bitcoin or some other altcoin that are out there, but you're actually removing that. And also, if I got it right, that would turn around your computation times within the blockchain drastically, because you don't need to wait for the proof of work to be done from all the participating nodes, or
yes.
is that how?
I can talk to those differences. So the question fundamentally is, how does CT work differently than a Bitcoin blockchain? So in Bitcoin, transactions get verified in chunks. Every 10 minutes, a block of transactions needs to be verified by the network. And the block size restriction that was a debate for going on for far too long was basically the transaction volume on Bitcoin couldn't keep up given the block size maximum. In the case of certificate transparency, what we put in the Merkle tree is different. It's not a list of a bunch of different transactions. So we don't have the same problem in regards to block size. The other question that you had was relative to transaction verification. So in Bitcoin, you're creating a hash collision over that block, more or less, to be able to verify that it is legitimate. And the first person who finds the hash collision, or partial hash collision, wins. I used to work for a company called 21, which was a Bitcoin miner. The goal is to win as much as possible. In certificate transparency, is no proof of work. The trust will come from this gossip component. So it's a lot more efficient than Bitcoin. It did not aspire to be fully distributed. I'm happy to talk about Bitcoin and how truly distributed it is or is not, maybe after the talk, if anybody would like to talk about that. But those are two problems that CT does not have. It does not have a block size problem, and it does not have that same transaction verification time problem, because it's not based off of proof of work. Let's see, what else can I tell you? CT is good. And please start logging. If you're a CA and you issue web PKI certificates, EJBCA supports logging. You can ask them to support the blasting methodology, because I think that they are currently synchronous. I'm sure that they would like to do that work if one of you were to ask for it, I'm sure. And then if you are a customer of a web PKI CA, please talk to them about the importance of being transparent and logging all of the certificates that they issue. It will make our ecosystem healthier in the long run. Thank you.